Well, I suppose I must bear some responsibility for the fact that we don't have a chairman sitting between us. I'm trying to pioneer a new method of public conversation in which we have a chairman to introduce us, a chairman to stop us promptly when we've gone too far, and I hope he will do that, I hope Mark will do that, but not a chairman to actually moderate the discussion itself, because I'm sure this wouldn't have happened with Mark Kay, but in my experience, having a chairman on the stage between two conversationalists spoils the conversation, because just when it's getting going, the chairman will change the subject. It's even worse when there are, say, four people on the panel, and there's a good conversation going between person A and person B, and just when person B is about to retort to person A, the chairman will jump in and say to person C, and what do you think about this? Yeah. And that completely derails the entire thing. Another thing that's even worse is the debate format. 20 minutes for the proposition, 20 minutes for the opposition, 5 minutes rebuttal, 5 minutes rebuttal. It's all derived from lawyers. Like so much else. So that's just my introduction to the format. In a way, apology. It throws an onus upon us to keep the conversation going, and so we're going to do our best. Lawrence.
Well, the other thing we want to let you know is that, as Mark alluded, we've already had a rather public dialogue that appeared in Scientific American, and actually an extended version is online, and I encourage you to look at that. But we also therefore decided that we would not try and reproduce that dialogue here because it's accessible to you. So we've assured that would be the case by making absolutely no preparations whatsoever for this event, and that may or may not be obvious. We'll see. But I'm going to begin by asking you, Richard, about your own philosophy about education. What drives your interest in public education and the techniques you use?
My job is Charles Simony Professor of the Public Understanding of Science at Oxford. And the benefactor, Charles Simony, explicitly wanted me to promote science to the general public rather than, for example, do research on how many people think the sun goes around the earth, yeah, or how many people don't know why we have a winter and a summer, that kind of thing. I mean, that's very interesting research, and you'd be shocked by the results.
In fact, you should know that 50% of the American public, every year the National Science Foundation has asked this question, do not get the answer right to the question, the earth goes around the sun and takes a year to do it, true or false. And as I like to say, we know who that 50% vote for, but in any case, but anyway.
There's a similar 50% who think that the world is 6,000 years old. And as I've said before, if you actually work out the scale of the error, it's equivalent to believing that the distance from New York to San Francisco is 7.8 yards. Yeah. Anyway, as I was saying, the Charles Simony Professor of Public Understanding of Science could devote himself or herself to, I say himself or herself, I'm retiring this year, and so my job has been advertised, and looking forward to seeing who gets it. It could have been devoted to that, or could have been devoted to, say, teaching how to communicate science. But the benefactor asked me to do it by promoting science. I think there are two main ways of thinking about science as an educationist. And I can illustrate it by talking about two approaches to space. There's the Carl Sagan approach to space, which is the sort of, isn't it wonderful? And that's my approach. And then there's what I call the non-stick frying pan approach, which is, oh, we must support NASA because non-stick frying pans were developed as a byproduct of... that's an extreme, but nevertheless, when I'm asked to justify science education, I do not, as some people do, leap first for the, oh, it's useful. For example, why preserve the Amazon rainforest? Oh, because we might be able to get drugs from the bark of trees. Maybe we can, but that's not why I want to preserve the Amazon rainforest. So I'm the Carl Sagan, the wonder of space, the beauty of the universe, the awe-inspiring nature of deep space, deep time, of deep complexity in biology. I don't go for exploding custard, whiz bangs, and things like that.
Well, okay, that's a really good point you pointed out, because my area of research is in something that, in all fairness, has absolutely no practical utility whatsoever. And the thing is, I'm often asked to apologize for that, and it is interesting to me that people ask, you know, what's the point of doing that if it's not useful? But they never ask that, or very rarely do they ask that about art or literature or music. It's not; those things are not going to produce a better toaster. And for me, I have to agree with you completely that the most fascinating thing about science is the ideas, is the lifting of the human spirit. And we remember the Greeks not for their plumbing, or the Romans not particularly for their plumbing, but for largely for their ideas. And why we have to justify that when we talk about science amazes me. And there's a quote from that I like to use from the first head of the Fermi National Accelerator Laboratory, which is a particle accelerator. Right now, in fact, it's the most energetic particle accelerator in the world, soon to be surpassed by a machine in Geneva, as may be many things about this country. And he was asked to testify before Congress, and he said, they asked him, would this aid in the defense of the nation? A typical thing. And he said, no, but it'll help keep the nation worth defending.
Yes.
Okay. And I think that's really important. Yeah, well, you can applaud for him. He's unfortunately deceased, but I'll let him know that you... but the other thing, though, that I have to say behind my philosophy of reaching out, and I know we have talked about this before a little bit, I believe in trying to explain the wonderful and mysterious nature of the universe, which is far more mysterious and interesting than any science fiction writer could ever come up with. But in order to get people to be receptive to that awe, I think you have to do a little work. For some reason or other, get asked to talk to teachers a lot, and I tell them that I think the biggest mistake that any teacher makes is to assume their students are interested in what they have to say. Now, it's actually true. It doesn't have to be a teacher. It could be car salesman, politician, anyone. I really do think you have to work and reach people where they are before they'll even be receptive, because they won't understand how it relates to anything they're interested in. So when I'm trying to reach people about science, I try to go to where they are in some sense, or work very hard. And that was the purpose behind the Star Trek book, for example. People. I think as a biologist, maybe you have this happen less to you than I do as a physicist, but when people ask me at a party, what do? And I say, well, I'm a physicist. And then they say, well, how about the baseball season?
I'm shocked. I'm horrified by that.
Yeah, I know. It's true. But then you say, well, what about time travel or something like that? And then people realize they're fascinated by those ideas, but they don't make the leap and realize in some sense that that's science, that the things that intrinsically fascinate people are really the things that we're lucky enough to be able to, in general, be paid to do. And so I think one has to try and find a hook. And as I say, in biology, you may not have found the hook, although the hook, in this case, one of the big interests, of course, is evolution. And it's kind of an anti-hook nowadays. And at least in the United States, the fact that evolution is so fascinating as an idea. And I think, by the way, that we physicists are also largely to blame in many ways for the fact that Darwin isn't appreciated more than he is. We did a wonderful public relations campaign for Albert Einstein. But I have to say, as I have over the last few years have spent time in the public debate about evolution versus intelligent design, I really do think that if I had to pick the greatest scientist of the last few hundred years, it would be Charles Darwin and not Albert Einstein, that a single person could so radically change an entire field, and combining observation and theory just amazes me, and we really should be promoting what a remarkable human achievement that was.